I'm already getting the numbers. And so I misled our other student rep. I let Noah had checked in with me, asked what time we were starting, and I said, we're going to start a little late. So, but by 6:40. We're not going to wait until 6:40. We're not going to go, and I will apologize to him. But we will start. All right, so Judy Nelson, here, Tom Cruise.
Here.
Andy Beach, here. Andrea Anderson.
Here, Mary Nash.
Here.
All right.
The United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Here he is.
We have received a couple of thank you notes for the luncheon that we did on Tuesday. I think it's been passing around, so it was effective at the time. Thanks to all the work done by Andy and the support from everyone else. All right, discussion items. The principal update.
I didn't have one for this month. We've had a week of school at that point, so obviously, for this month, I'll update you on. We have very successful open house sponsor, as you know, from the year here. The families turned out great feedback so far this year. You can already see parts of Opal School. If you don't have to walk around, if you were to go into the limitations room, you would see evidence of Opal School and Becky's room. There's pictures on the Facebook of the kids making letters with sticks and things of different nature, so you can already see parts of our professional learning from the springtime in the building, which is great to see it already integrated into our daily practices. So we're off to a great start.
That's great. I did attend the open house and was able to go into every single room. It's just amazing what had already happened. Thank you. And now we'll go to the student rep thing. Welcome back to our student reps. Both are seniors. Bailey is a senior at Hanford High School. Noah is a senior at Marshall High School, correct?
Yes.
I don't want to send you off out into the world too soon. All right, so welcome back. Bailey has been a stalwart. Not only is she involved in grade school, she's been a rep for quite a few years, and we appreciate it. So, anyways. All right, so Noah, you're first on the agenda, so Noah,
layout is making also largely expanded the parking lot to the point that we now have a surplus of parking space. Very helpful for people visiting the school, or if there are emergency circumstances, people are able to get in more efficiently.
That's amazing. So on the first day that we saw the new cafeteria structure opening, how much confusion was there?
It was rather difficult. Probably expected the first year or so, it's usually solid, it's a fresh, you know, what I'm doing, it's for no way.
So, must have been amazing. I hope somebody was still there. Thank you, Noah. Bailey?
So, all of our clubs and everything like that are kind of back into the swing of things, starting this week. So our Interact Club, which is a community service club, is up and interacting with new members. We actually have quite a few freshmen who are joining, which is awesome. And we're planning some early fundraisers to build up our funds so we can have funds to build off of to give back to our community. And we're also planning some volunteer opportunities with the Summer Third Craft Department. Youth to Youth is working on starting a program in the middle school, which is something that they had a while back, but then it kind of fizzled out, so they're trying to bring that back. Student Council is planning the annual Spirit Week. That's going to be in early October with the Spirit Rally following the end of the week on Friday. We really just get students as a community just ready for the year. National Honor Society is working on sending out care packages for the victims of Hurricane Harvey. So we've actually been in contact with quite a few schools in Texas that have really explicitly stated what they need. So we're working on that. And then we're also volunteering at UNH on September 23rd in their concession stand. As far as our inductions and admissions go for National Honor Society, we hand out packets for new applicants, which will be due the 27th of this month. And then the induction ceremony is the 18th of next month. Our math team is really back up this year. Our first practice will be next Wednesday, which is really exciting. I love math. Really exciting for me. As far as our classes go, our freshmen just had their elections on Wednesday. So everyone knowing where their offices are, which is really nice. The sophomores are planning fundraisers for their prom and really getting ahead. The juniors are scooping out fundraisers as well for prom, and their prom is May 19th. And then the senior class is participating in Loudoun on September 24th. We're also scouting out senior banquet locations and working on planning the Halloween dance, which is a great fundraiser for us. As far as sports go, field hockey has an away game at Dover tomorrow at 4:45. Soccer has a game next Saturday at Laconia, so they have this week off. And then football has their first home game on Sunday at 7 p.m. And then Sunday, yeah, I'm not entirely sure how that plays. Yeah.
Because I
got
earlier on Sunday.
Yeah. And then our open house is tonight from 6 to 7:30.
Well, it sounds like so both of you are every day you're saying this is the last time I'll have my third days walking to the school. We all know, right? You're
absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Don't want you to miss a minute of your
No, you don't have pictures too, documenting it.
Yep. Mom's giving advice. Yes. Remember those days. Anyway, as usual, you both are welcome to stay and join us. But I know school has started and you have other obligations and stuff that you need to do. So you're also excused. Thank you both.
Have a nice night.
Thank you. All right, the next discussion item is the New Hampshire School Board Association's call for resolutions. I didn't bother handing everything out and bringing everything along. This is every year they have their calls for resolutions. We have never, as far as I know, as a board, there were deadlines though if we wanted to, correct? I'm sorry, I disagree with you. Can you share those deadlines?
November 3rd, which is a Friday, is the proposed resolution. And the delegate assembly is January 20, 2018.
Andrea, is that you? The New Hampshire School Association delegate?
That me?
Or is it me and you're the alternate? I'll have to look it up.
It might be me.
Anyway, we'll look it up. So that we know who's attending, right?
So thank you.
You're welcome. So if it's me, I think it's me. Anyway. It's a very interesting day, the day that it is spent there. One year they held it, it's usually on a Saturday, I believe.
It looks like a Saturday, January 20th.
Right? I believe that's when it is. And one year the Patriots had a playoff game that year. And you never saw so many anxious people saying, when is this ending? When is it, can we skip lunch? When is this ending? We don't get to get home. So I think from then on they've checked.
Yeah, I think I volunteered for that.
Okay, and so we don't need to have any other one. All right. Action items. As you can see on the agenda, this is the action items of all of the policies that we brought up for discussion last time. So we can either go over them one by one, or we can ask if there's discussion on any of them to start with. How would the board like to be handled?
I have one question I didn't remember seeing last time we looked at these. And I'm sorry, I'm trying to find it. It's about the food service stuff. I noticed that there is something about summer school.
Food service, it's EFAA.
Online parent option. The Summers for a School Department offers parents an online parent option. The website is imilton.com. Information may be found on SAU 56 website. Which made me think we should include that information for.
So it's. Oh, I see. But this is. So this is. You're finding this under the ones that are marked Rossford, right?
Yeah, I should say
Rossford. And we're mentioning Summers for this. Online payment, there it is, we are mentioning it.
But it's for the, I assumed it was for the Rollinsford district, right? That's why it would include something about summer sports.
Well, it is, but technically, the Rollinsford district is not part of, we're in the same SAU, but we're not part of the Summersworth school district.
Right,
so I see your point.
I thought, well, clearly our Rollinsford students going to Summersworth would need this information. That was my assumption as to why it was included, but
no. This it is, while these policies apply to our students in this school, and some of our policies we have so that we can. Our students have to follow the policies, correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Brown, have to follow the policies of the school district they're in, unless ours are, like, in a way, a more restrictive.
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
So it should say the Rollinsford School Department offers parents an online payment option?
And do we?
Yes.
Oh, well, that's lovely.
Well, it wasn't really, my thought was that we should be including Marshwood as well. So we should be excluding Summersworth. Okay. So do you guys see that? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Page 2.
And it should end.
Yeah, correct.
It should read Rollinsford there.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Summersworth.
I know that the attempt that when the executive group meant to do it is to bring forward the ones that were recommended. And I,
which are optional. We do tend to use the simplified rules of order. Some of the board does not choose to use them. So this one came to this board, but not to the Sunday School Board. But all the rest of them, I believe, are either by recommended or required by law.
I have a question just for my own education. In the audio and video surveillance and school buses, the ECAF, the people who are allowed to view only after expressly authorized by the superintendent, superintendent or designee, business administrator, building administrator, or law enforcement officer. Why would a business administrator need to see? Is it destruction of property? Is that?
The business administrator oversees transportation.
Okay.
So that falls under their responsibility, so they may need to see a particular.
Right. That makes perfect sense. I was just curious.
People like just another moment. Can we, is it okay if we do them as a whole? Yes, can we do them as a whole? Then we will have a motion to accept basically the list.
I'm going to accept all policies on our agenda. Second.
Any further discussion?
We do make a motion to make the adjustment.
I think with the correction, it's an edit, it's not really a change, so yeah, recommend it. You're all set on the motion?
Mm-hmm.
And the second, we have a second?
Yes.
Any further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, that was our action item. Financial update. So we have the current budget for the current year. We have the last year's budget came through really just before the meeting, so most of us have not had a chance to take a look at that. And then we also have some other things sort of on the list here to talk about. But do we want to get an overview? Marie, did you want to address anything first or?
No. Yeah, any questions? The initial, this year's budget that was initially sent was early before we encumbered money, and we just encumbered today. Most up-to-date information with the encumbrances. And the encumbrances that were reflected in the salary benefits, the SAU assessment, we have a lease agreement for the copier and transportation. So those are basically what we've encumbered today. Everything else, historically, it's reflected on what is actually spent. The other thing that was from the initial one for this year, the Summersworth high school tuition was encumbered because we knew how many students were definitely here as of September. With Marshwood, we were still going back and forth on students, and we needed to confirm the status of the students' work, so we didn't encumber that at this point in time. So it will be encumbered at the next, next board packet.
Yeah, that some of the things being, I did notice that the tuition too had not been encumbered. And that's a big chunk, so it makes it look like we have a lot of money. Some of the others are smaller, but we also did not encumber special ed transportation.
That's something that needs to be looked at. Again, it's something else that we're working on.
Okay. And the goal, we've had this discussion a number of times, a number of years in a row we've had years where everything gets encumbered and then it gets unencumbered as things change going around. We've tried to strike a balance now of making sure that things that we know, things that we have an obligation to pay, like tuition and all that, get encumbered. And then as it gets finer, as each month goes by, we might unencumber some of that money, like tuition to medical. If we didn't have the count them down, or
so are there still questions about where students
Not at this point. We just, I got confirmation from our special ed director saying that he's not having students or in the program. So as of now, no, but things can change next month. There's a fluctuation of kids coming and going. The other thing is on last year's budget, I'm just finalizing the report. Basically have the final numbers. I have to translate that into the state reports. So I'm in the process of doing that and should have it ready next week, the board to sign. Probably instead of coming in twice, I'll have, when Katie sends out the email that the manifest is ready to sign, it would be advantageous that you sign everything. Once I have it completed, I will send it to the state department of revenue and I have to send them the signed copy. So we're almost there.
We're almost there. And it looks very much like it did in June. Looks like there haven't been major changes there. So one of the things that confuses me a lot, and so I'm going to ask Marie if we can walk through it perhaps another time, is how the warrants get. So if you look at the bottom of the summary page, the warrants are listed from essentially the warrants that were passed in March. So in March, we're voting on the next school year's budget. So in March of 16, we voted on the 17-18 budget, the year we just started right now. And then they get added to the 17-18 budget, I guess, is what it looks like. As needed to be money to be raised, correct?
Well, we don't. As I listed it on the bottom,
mm-hmm.
each one article is voted on separately,
mm-hmm.
and so each one that passed is reflected on here. So the $5,555,000 is the overall budget, which included all that information that we spoke about in detail, the sections and all that. That's what that amount is.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you remember on Warren Article 5, it had a default budget in case it didn't pass. The difference was very minor, mm-hmm. insignificant. But the original budget passed, so that's what's in here. Then we had budget Warren Article number 6, which was the agreement, and it did not pass. So it's not added in here. So Warren Article number 6 was the...
Yep, go ahead.
Warrant Article 7 was maintenance for the ADA mm-hmm. lift, and that was passed for $45,500. And that, I indicated, was put to the maintenance line, because that's where it is. It's maintained, the building.
Okay.
So that was added to the $5,555,000. The next thing that passed was another maintenance item, was the annex phase of the three-phase electrical power that was installed. Or was approved to do.
Mm-hmm.
So that is also added into the budget. Then we had two separate other warrant articles to be put in each individual trust fund, $25,000 each, and that also passed. So if you add the $5,555,000, all the other warrant articles that passed equals the $5,730,656,000, which if you look at the first column of the budget, it ties to that,
mm-hmm.
and your revenue ties to that.
Okay.
So I hope that explains.
No, it helps a lot, and what really helps a lot is now is seeing where it's where allocated to the line and the maintenance. That's very helpful.
Because
in the past, we've seen the maintenance line go way up, and I've always had to ask why did the maintenance line go up so far from what we budgeted, what was in the budget that we voted on? Why did the maintenance line go up so much? And it's because of the warrants. Okay. That's very helpful to me. I have two more questions. So in revenue, the transfer from general fund, that's the $50,000. That's the on the same page there. That's the $25,000 for those two warrants.
So it comes from the last year's fund balance. If there's one left. So that becomes revenue from the prior year, mm-hmm. goes into the revenue side, and then we take that money that we received because that was remaining, and then we
budget at this point, and I know we haven't had time to look at last year's.
Additional services.
Sorry?
Additional services on 1617. It's negative, it's line, sorry, I should say, I think it's 2190. It's negative 1756.
2190.
It's the first line that's red on the right.
Do you have the backup for it, so we can just do the extra coming together as well?
It's the 1617.
2190 is adaptive physical education. So you're looking at page 4 of 8.
Yeah.
On this is last year's budget, you look at page 4 of 8.
Yeah.
Look at 21, and so that was equipment that we had budgeted for
okay.
special education. They needed specific equipment, and they spent more than what we budgeted for that line. Do you see it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? We could come back to this, at the next, mm-hmm. And then I'll have the actual. Breakout that I send to the selectmen and the board, and I'll have that figured out as well. So you'll have that within the next 2 weeks.
Okay, no, that's helpful. I did want to make sure, and I think you've answered this question in the past, the election services, that does include the cost of the ballots, correct?
Yes.
As not as well as paying our election fees.
Yes.
Is that not as expensive as I thought?
And some of the officials don't. They waive it.
Yes, I can quote them. It's not worth cashing a check.
Well,
they don't get paid right for that day. It's for sure. I'm now working on 3 different copies of them, so I apologize for looking at my questions. Can you just remind me, and again, I probably ask this every year, the difference between school board services and school board? Is the school board employee?
What year are you looking at?
Well, either year. I just want to know what's included in school board services and what's included in school board, what the differences are there. And school board services is $4,000.
2311 is... Yeah. It's the secretary, the school board officer's salaries.
Okay.
And benefits. And you could look at, you could see on, it's on page 5 of 8. I'm looking at,
again. More to detail.
Looking at 1617. Look at page 5 of 8. 2311 is general administration, and it lists what those items are. School board officers' salaries, you see what I'm talking about? School improvement, postage, advertising, it's related to school board.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 2010 is basically the school board association.
That's the students.
Front sheet is summarized.
All right. So, and some of this is going to become important as we have some discussions later on some of the things we're doing for our community outreach and stuff. So the amount of money we have to spend. So I just wanted to make sure it would come out of that line.
Yes, and I think one of the questions on the agenda is, it says. Cost of newsletter. So if you look at this year's budget, and I'll tell you what page that is.
Mm-hmm.
It's also school board services.
Oh, this is the correct percent.
And it's postage on page 5 of 8.
Okay.
There's a budget of $200 for postage. Is everybody there?
Mm-hmm.
And there was a mailing that was done recently, and you can see the cost of that mailing was $189.71. Did everybody follow that?
Mm-hmm.
So that was across the one, and it's a bulk mailing, so we get it at this amount of rate.
That's each time now.
That's each time. That's each time. That was just one mailing.
Right.
That's very good.
Yeah. And we've done two. We did, well, one went out on the last year's, I think. I think it went out in July, before we hit the end of the year. And one went out this year.
I'll go back and check that and see what that line says.
What do we use? $800 on half of that. $665 of that last year.
No, that's a very good question. So that's why that's easy to find out.
Okay.
For posting of jobs?
For the
school board?
School jobs?
So it comes out of the school board's budget?
Yes. To post the jobs?
Yeah.
That's $1,800.
Okay. Background check.
What? Is there a special background check?
No.
School improvements?
I think, I have to go back and look, but it was something that board had approved to some kind of.
That was the grant, right?
The grant.
And it wasn't quite 5,000. Something else.
Well, it was a grant match.
Yeah.
The grant match. Was it security?
It was probably both. We did a historical grant match, and we did the cameras that we matched also. That must be that.
So if you have any further questions, you want more detail, just email us and we'll get back to you.
Okay. Well, as we get into budget season, we're all trying to get up to date on the budget. Thank you. Other specific area?
No,
that's just my usual face.
Oh.
It looked like a very intense face. All right. So the cost of the mailing is to these specific questions that are on the budget. It's $189. And that bulk mailing, is it every door direct kind of thing?
Yes. There's different sections that get allocated, A, B's, and.
Yeah, because we have two sections.
But there's three of them.
Well, I know we have two, and I don't know, we don't have a way, I don't believe, of getting mailers to people who actually have a Summersworth mailing address.
Oh, I love Summersworth. The post office directs us what label to put on, and when they're put together, they're done in different colors,
yes.
So the sections are done appropriately. So it's based on whatever, it's one, two, or three. I don't know what areas cover those.
Yep. One's the village, I think. One's the we get it delivered on mailboxes. Okay, so that will be a discussion we'll have in the community connections. And basically, under budget here was the cost of staff appreciation events and associated schedules. We'll do that under community connections as we talk about, sort of how we want to handle those things this year and how we want to keep track of what we're spending and how we're doing them now. And then so the other one on here is the CIP breakout, which we sent out from last year, because it was the only one I had. Oh, I sent it out to the. It was included in our packet, I believe.
Yeah.
And I did share that with the town CIP committee. I was not able to attend. We had our first negotiating session that evening. What I am suggesting, and I'd like the board's input on this, is that the budget, school board's budget committee rep, who this year is me, and Emily's the backup. I think should be involved in the schools coming up with the school CIP stuff. So we're just better informed as we go along through the year, rather than getting the last piece of paper. And if possible, for that person to also work with the town CIP. So if the town knows the types of things that are coming down the road, if the town knows that the annex is going to need a new roof in a few years. So the town is. People putting together the town budget aren't somewhat surprised too. So, what do you guys think about that?
just curious why we wouldn't have already been involved.
Well, we've been trying. We've been trying. So I'm hoping it'll sort of...
What do you mean, though, by that?
Asking to be invited, trying to get it going, trying to get... this is only, it surprises me, but this is only Dick Fortier's third year, fourth year? I mean, last year was just his third year, right? Sorry, his fourth year. And so we didn't have this kind of forward thinking. You know, we didn't have the IEB study that we all quote all the time. We didn't have those things that helped him get a handle on things, and he was the one who helped put it together, who has helped put it together. So we haven't had the ability to be part of it. And then the town has also, you know, had various fits and starts with it as well. So that's the reason.
Well, I think it makes perfect sense if we're able to have that commitment and do that.
Yeah, I think you really do need to be part of our conversation. I think part of it too is that we've been looked at as well, you know, why didn't we know this was happening? But now, you know, everybody would know when everything's happening in real time. How often are these folks meeting?
They've met once this year, as far as I know.
Okay.
It was the night of our first negotiation.
And how often are they?
I don't know. I've asked to be invited to them all. So. So it's really fun. One of the things I would like to do is actually go through the IEB study and that list in the closet of all the things. And I actually believe that a number of those items have been addressed. We've been chipping away at them. Dick and his crew have been chipping away at them. I think we might be able to, you know, some of the big ticket items, of course, you saw made significant progress. It would be nice to be able to report that to the town. A good thing. All right, any other budget things to talk about? Okay. All right, new business. So on here you see the listed residency policy. And I'm happy to jump in, or do you want to take the lead on this?
Sue, just to set the stage a little bit for this discussion, there have been a question of residency a couple of times so far since the school year started. And I look to see if you have a policy, you don't. The School Boards Association is developing a model policy. So what I recommend at this point is to wait and see what they bring forward. We also got from Marshwood what they're using to establish residency, which is actually pretty good. So I think what we'll be able to do is to take the school board's policy and cut and paste some of the things from the Marshwood policy and put it in. But I think that is lacking right now as we try to certify residents and whether someone might have a foot in both camps, so to speak. That would be helpful to you. It would be helpful to us because we could refer to your policy.
Yeah.
So that sort of opens that door.
Yeah, and as you know, I mean, it's important. We don't want to be paying tuition for someone that isn't really a resident of Rollinsford. And I'll also add that the town clerk is very interested in being a part of, once we get a policy, the town clerk will review it as well, because the town clerk has some standards that she uses for residency purposes. And it'd be great in the policy, she'll then make sure the policy includes her, you know, that are up to her standards as well, so we're all on the same page. Right? Like, you know, maybe Marshwood accepts a lease. Well, the town clerk does not accept a lease for the name on it. Is there anyone can write a lease and put their name on it? There has to be something more official that comes to that address with their name on it. So those kinds of things. So she'll be involved with that. So just to make note of our sort of our third goal, we're doing a lot more. We're doing that outreach, working with people. We're going to be working with the town clerk. We're going to be working with the CIP committee and those kinds of things. We're continuing with that.
Do we know, is there an expected time when the School Board Association will have their policy release?
I heard this fall, so that gives them some room to develop that. If I don't see it by, say, delegate assembly, I'll see if I can nudge them a little bit, because I know a number of districts are asking for that.
we've hobbled along, and I think, you know, I don't feel that we've been taken advantage of, but it's just good to have this policy in place.
I think so too.
And the other thing, there was a question was raised last time, Connie, about if you had talked with Dr. Nash about a student who might be a 50-50 arrangement for custody.
I did talk to Dr. Nash about that, and she's open to perhaps splitting the tuition. I think what we'd like to do is to have the policy developed and approved and then talk about what may be unique circumstances. She is open to doing that.
So just my question, so the policy would probably include something like that, right? So, or do we think or don't we know?
It may. The draft that I have from her, this is a residency affidavit, talks about parents who live together, the type of legal residence, they live apart, they're divorced, they have joint legal custody, they have primary residence. It doesn't speak to tuition per se, but it does map out half a dozen circumstances that the family may find itself in. So that I think will be useful once you get some of these unique situations worked out. But she was open to it.
Thank you. Any other new business from? So community connections. We've got a mail route. Thanks to really remarkable work being done by this crew here. And they're watching. Yeah, good stuff.
Well done. Stuff.
Please sit up.
Yeah, we had a nice lunch with the staff over our guests on your first day back. Which was lovely. Some of us were able to
visit with everyone.
Yeah. About the good work that happened in the summer and is continuing.
They just seemed excited to be back and looking forward to the new year. So,
that's about it.
All right, do we want to talk a little bit about, or do we want time to sort of review money and sort of what we might have available before we start thinking about other events? I mean, there are a number of other events where we like to, you know, pitch it and send something in for staff to eat and things like that, and the mail we want to keep up. So we want to think about that and discuss it more in depth next time as we're setting up, for instance, the budget for next year.
Yeah, I definitely think that this isn't going to cut it.
Right.
We don't want to, we're obviously seeing tonight that is not going to cut our postage budget.
It's gone.
So there's that.
Those categories always been, you know, that designation, or that, you know, do we have the ability to sort of move around?
Yeah, we have the ability to say let's yeah. We do. We have the ability to say let's cut legal by 2,000 and hope we don't need, you know, any more than like $5,000 in our legal assistance and put it into. We have the ability to do that.
I was thinking about the newsletter a little bit, and I think that we could potentially mail less frequently, but do more things online. Some of the FAQ that we had talked about, and then we do send a newsletter kind of linked to those FAQ that we've done in the meantime. We can get the word out electronically as well when those FAQ go up, and then the newsletters can go out a little bit less frequently. That would potentially save some dough.
That's a good
right.
Yeah, I mean, we don't. I mean, it's I mean, the reason, of course, we're trying to get a piece of paper into every door is that there are a number of people who don't go online. But I think if we get in there enough,
right. So find a balance, maybe.
Yeah.
It's quite expensive, I guess.
Yeah. All right, so we'll just continue to think about that and keep an eye on and maybe pick some. Obviously, with budget season coming up, there'll be certain
maybe by the time we talk next month, we'll sort of pinpoint when we want to do our next one. Sounds good. Anything else on that?
Well, do we want to decide now that, you know, we had initially thought we were going to do once every month, right?
Yes, we're already down to every other month. We're already down to that.
Right.
At least in our practice.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Maybe we cut back to three throughout the year, so we do a beginning, middle, and end of school year kind of thing, and then do the others online, writing down, and post them in the end card, in the library, at the board, at the town hall.
We usually do an election day in the other, too, so if the parents are there.
So maybe that will be our mid one?
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe that will be our mid one.
But I think these are good. Sounds like we've already cut it down to, at least in half, if not both.
Okay.
The Marshwood contract items. This is a list that I hope you have a copy of somewhere, because we don't. These are things that have come up over the last couple of years that I believe next year will be contract renewal time. In terms of extension time, not renewal, contract extension time. I believe the term was 10 years. We're going 6 years, 6 years, and then we're going to renew it for another 4 years, but I believe the renewal is going to happen long before those 4 years come out. So these are things that we wanted to just sort of bring up to talk, perhaps change a little bit of some of the way things are handled. I can't remember them specifically now, but I know we have a short list. But there should be a folder or something.
Yeah, Jenny's.
There was a folder.
There's been track of just things that we mentioned throughout the year that we want to be good with in the year.
Like the exchange student.
The exchange student, right?
That's right, that's right.
We're just saying there's a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Just that automatic stuff.
And, well, the anecdote, yeah. But, the exchange student was one, I know.
Right, they bus.
And some of that stuff has worked out.
Some of it's worked out. That's right.
Over time, but we'll do that list and see how we can go forward.
One of the things I'd like to propose we consider sooner rather than later is moving from an itemized special ed costing per service to either a tiered replacement cost or something other than what you have now in the Linux Ag. It takes hours for both districts to go through and do that itemization. And I don't think that in terms of frugality it's all that helpful to you. And I think for budget purposes it would be better if we could anticipate whether it's a tier one or tier two or tier three, those being the most restrictive and expensive to the least restrictive or vice versa. I think you've had a go with the system now for 2 years, maybe? Or 3 years?
Well, this is our third year.
Yeah.
So in terms of budgeting, this is our third time budgeting form. Three budget.
So if that's something you would be amenable to, I'd like to approach Dr. Nash and initiate that. We have a meeting the end of September, right, Marie? And have them start to So I would place it on the table for your consideration to see if that's something you would support moving forward, or...
Well, that is our agreement with Summersworth. It's tiered. So our students that remain in Summersworth, we did a tiered process for special ed, and it was 1, 2, 3, and I forget which way it went, but, from the most to the least. And it does appear to be much simpler to deal with. And when you say hours and hours, I think you really mean days and days of hours, right? I mean, it takes a lot of time to go through.
It does take days and days and hours of hours. I'm talking about billing. So it just, I think it would be simpler for all to move to a system that is, because we do this without a district placement, so we don't look at them other than for a yearly cost. And there are things that you can add in, if you need a pair, if you need specialized equipment, that would be separate. But a placement cost and say a resource room is tier one. So I want, I think it would be helpful to both. I see people knowing it.
So is this Marshall, I mean, obviously it sounds like this was Marshall, the original agreement we have with them now was from Marshall.
That's correct, that's correct. They proposed that and we just went forward with that. That is correct.
Okay. Because otherwise I would imagine we would have gone with what we were doing in Summersworth already.
Well, no. But we were, when we were in the area agreement, it was completely different.
Okay.
So
I mean, as far as this tiered idea, I mean, this is what we've been doing with Summersworth all along.
No. A very quick history. When we were in the area agreement, the special education costs were essentially added to each student. So it was a tuition, I'm going to call it a tuition figure for each student. So right now, it was a flat fee, but it included special ed for whoever needed special ed. They sort of came up with a sort of a one big number and spread it out over all the students that we had. When we went to a strict tuition agreement with Summersworth, we had the base tuition and then an additional cost at a tiered pricing for any special ed students.
Okay, now I remember.
Yeah, it's, I know it's...
But part of this was sort of driven outside of our ability.
Yes.
We were getting hammered with questions from the town, very specific questions which we could not answer, as to cost for services.
For special ed, that's correct.
And that really was, that sort of steered the ship a little bit. One question on this. You could potentially see an issue in the district saying, well, this is a great way to make some extra dollars. How are we going to determine what tier? For example, if we have a student that we believe is a certain level, and they're saying, it's this level, how is that worked out?
I would believe those costs would be driven by an IEP. And so Ryan's able to resource from a sort of a light touch and services, and you can say that's half an hour a day times whatever support, as opposed to a self-contained program with more support would be, to use the tier three example.
Yeah.
And so that's driven by your IEP cost.
Okay.
And placement. I don't see it as that dissimilar to other district placements currently. Depends on what services you need.
And that raises a question I have too, Tom, but essentially, our New Hampshire special ed folks oversee our students there in that to make sure that they are receiving the services that New Hampshire requires them to receive. And we've already had, it's not going to change that our special ed people are not going to be involved. It's going to be.
But I do recall in the beginning there was some conflict.
And it continues every year.
Yeah, so that is, it's really sort of keeping, finding the score about that, because there were some disagreements about things that were being provided. And as I know, this is a few days here, but it was kind of a reason a lot of this stuff came up. We had a lot of different questions that were being asked, and we were trying to dig in a little bit ourselves into what drove the cost, what was it exactly. And then when we were talking about when we had moved to Marshall, there were some issues, and we were trying to figure out, how is this all going to work. So, but I think this whole idea of the tiered system, we're in agreement with it. I think far in there, long as it's right.
And so I guess the question I would have is it would take away the hours and hours of going through saying, did they get this hour of service, did they get this hour, but it would not take away the oversight of making sure they're following the New Hampshire IEP.
That's correct.
Right?
Yeah.
That's the key.
I'm not saying it's purely financial, but it's a way to manage your special ed costs as opposed to just sort of an itemized list. And I don't know if they'll be open to talking about it. If they're not, then the contract comes around again. I think this is something that you want to consider with them. But I'd like to open the discussion as early as this month and say this would make life a lot simpler for a lot of people.
So consensus on having Connie have that conversation, start that conversation?
Okay, thank you.
Good,
thank you.
And thank you for thinking about it. Andrea, any update on late start times?
I have not heard any more about
So there haven't been any other meetings or anything. Interestingly enough, for those of you who don't know, the Northwood School District is forced to have a late start because there aren't enough buses and bus drivers. They are now starting school at 10 o'clock. Because that's when the buses can get the students. So I mean that's very interesting. There have been a few interesting programs on
state of middle school and high school.
Actually, I don't know which schools are starting late, but I know that they're
the elementary.
Is it elementary
starting from 10:30 to 4:30?
It's K-8.
K-8, and they're going 10 to 4:30.
Yes, because other towns' buses are running their buses in their towns. And then going to run the bus, and so they can't. Yeah. And so there's no transportation to the high school.
Which by law you're not required to. So. Thank you.
Well, I've heard from people that I work with about some of the more main towns are going through the same issue with bus drivers and buses. The kids are getting to school sometimes 45 minutes late at the elementary level, which I just.
It's nationwide, the shortage of drivers, and we live in the Seacoast area where the job rate is the unemployment rate is so low. The owner of C&J, Jim Delbert, he complains about not being able to find drivers. You just can't find people to do the work. So it's an interesting times. All right. Anyway, thank you, Andrea. All right, future meetings. We have an SAU meeting this coming Monday. And I know the agenda has been sent out. I really haven't had a chance to take a look at that. It would be an important one for people to try to attend if they can.
Well, that's all right, because Matt will be there.
The Marshwood meetings are coming up October 12th. October 12th, please note, even though we have a 6:30 meeting, but we also have a 5:30 budget meeting on the 12th of October. And Marie will have the budget out to us, at least in the usual time, at least a week ahead of time, right?
Well, we usually have discussion.
We have discussion before you do one. Okay. All right, we'll be ready for discussion.
That's right, discussion.
Okay. So we won't have a proposed budget yet to start with.
No, we have to have a couple
of discussion. Okay. So, okay, 5:30 discussion.
Very important 5:30 discussion on the 12th. Before our next scheduled meeting. Right?
Yes, 5:30. So 5:30 on October 12th. And no one should forget Family Fun Day, a week from Saturday.
So,
kicks off Family Fun Day, and I understand you have to have a little detour around Pine Street.
We do, that's true.
Okay. It's the culvert work going on in town. Well, it's the culvert work going on in town. Are the buses, do you know, are all the buses now going down or leaving the right way?
Yeah, we have them.
You have them?
Yes.
Well, the first day of school,
worked out beautifully.
The engineer, the town's engineer, who's overseeing some of the work being done, making sure it's being done properly, checked in with Principal Lucas to say, would it be okay if we paved that day? At which point, Principal Lucas said, well,
perfectly, except from 8:40, and between 8:30 and 8:40, and again from 2:50 to 3:15. It sounds great.
So,
It worked out beautifully.
And apparently it did work out beautifully. Our engineer was here that day seeing it, the select board member he was talking with said, and how did the buses go? He said, oh, it went fine. He said, they all went down. He said, except for one driver who chose to make a 17-point turn instead. So one bus did not go out there.
In the afternoon.
All right, we do have non-public. Is there, first we will get into any school events? Are we going to open house?
No, another one, so I'll see my conferences. And...
Okay. All right, closing comments by visitors.
Tracy Lori, I was just thinking when you guys were talking about the web and cutting down on the postage and stuff like that. If you guys did, you know, maybe small poster board size of whatever you're putting up on the web and place it at the town hall, at the library, at the post office, at places like that, so that that information where people are out and about, you know, it's on the web, it's this. So those in-between times, if we post it, we could post it here at the school. We could post it at the prominent places in a, you know, bigger than a regular piece of paper, and that might help visually get the word out there for those that aren't on the web.
Thank you. Celia Leopold, I'm going to ask, like I always do, will the board consider getting babysitting for during the meetings? I know Marshwood has a 50-hour requirement for community service, and that some of the Marshwood students have already volunteered to babysit for other meetings held here at the school. And I don't know if Principal Lucas is okay with us using the building for babysitting.
The board would always love to offer childcare. We have not had the bandwidth to organize it. We're happy to have any parent organize it or whatever. And usually the school is open to
we do it for other things,
if we can find some reliable young people who...
I'm happy to put it out in the next newsletter asking for kids that used to go to RGS that might be looking to do community service and see if anybody volunteers. I have a young boy that has already contacted me and is going to be doing PTO, so I'll see if there are other kids that might want to do it on the school board.
You're asking specifically for like school board meetings.
Yeah, for meetings held by this board. And then in regards to your conversation about special ed, I spent several years in special ed. If you go to a tiered system, the schools themselves still keep track of the individual services rendered. So there's a backup copy, so you could go back and look if you needed.
We appreciate the clarification, but as Dr. Brown was saying, this is truly a moral way to track finances. We're not talking about any changes to IEP for the services that they receive or how they're overseen, is what I'm understanding. So thank you for the clarification. Other comments by visitors? Comments from the board. We'll go around. Okay. All right, looks like we're all set. We do have non-public, so a notice to go into non-public.
Yes.